day. And you will get an opportunity to meet the other pastors later. But as you feel comfortable to do so, would you please rise for the call to worship and then the opening hymn? Gather the people. Darkness has spread over the land.
We come to the altar for the cross of the bridge.
God beckons. Return to me with all your heart.
Sustain me with all your heart.
Have mercy according to your steadfast love.
Create in me a clean heart.
Today is the day of salvation. And you will find the United Methodist hymnal in front of your pews. And if you will please turn to page 580, we will sing, Lead On, O King Eternal.
The crowd watched and the leaders scoffed, He saved others, they said, let him save himself if he is really God's Messiah, the chosen one. The soldiers mocked him too by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, if you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. A sign was fastened above him with these words, this is the King of the Jews. The word of God for the people of God.
Spreading the sharing of God's truth. invite you to Bethel to spend time with us. And there our pastor, our caravan pastor, will be very available for your pastor.
Good evening. If you are able to, I would ask that you stand as we, in unison, would read the mission statement. Together, in the spirit of love and contrition, we, the Lenten Caravan, gather together during the Lenten season to praise the Lord. As brothers and brothers in Christ, we understand the need to come together as partners in the common struggle to enhance the spiritual, physical, emotional, economical, and political health of our community. We can accomplish this by asking the Holy Spirit to empower us to love so we may become a true Christian community. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm here to introduce our messenger for this evening's service. He is the Reverend Dr. Clyde W. Oden, Jr. He is the pastor of Bethel, African Methodist Episcopal Church here in Oxnard. He was appointed to this position on October 25th, 2015. Bethel is one of the largest and oldest predominant African American congregations in Ventura County. He is also an adjunct professor at Payne Theological Seminary, Wilberforce, Ohio, where he serves as a mentor in their DMAN program, leading a cohort in community development. The Reverend Dr. Clyde Oden has had three careers. He was one of the first African Americans to serve as a clinical practitioner in optometry at Kaiser Permanente in Oakland, California. He spent 33 years in community health care at the Watts Health Foundation Incorporated and Watts Health Systems Incorporated, and finally 22 years as a pastor in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. His commitment has always been community focused, with an acute concern for the poor, the undeserved, and the disenfranchised people of color. He was married for 47 years to the late Velma L. Oden, R.N. He is the proud father of three adult children, seven great-grandchildren, and two great-great-grandchildren. It is my honor to introduce to some and present to others my pastor, the Reverend Dr. Clyde Oden, Jr., hear God's messenger. Amen.
Amen.
Church, we ought to have a big tent. We don't have to be one in which we require everybody to do the same, to conform to the same things. In fact, Jesus was not about conformity. And although we sometimes fail to negotiate very well our differences, and sometimes we merely tolerate one another, when we are at our best, we're being like Jesus. And above all, Jesus is about love. Jesus is about love, and he wants all of creation to understand that the creator of the universe, the sustainer of the cosmos, the eternal, the great I am, God Almighty, is love. And representing God's love is Jesus' assignment on this earth. It was love that created us. It is God's love that sustains us. And it was God's act of love that started us all. Our earliest biblical witness in the book of Genesis says that God, the God of the universe, took plain dust of the ground, dirt, blew into it the breath of life, and humans became living beings, created, as the psalmist says, just a little lower than the angels. Then after creating human beings, and after some acts of disobedience, God spoke to Adam and Eve as they were being evicted from the garden. And he said, by sweat on your brows you will have food to eat until you return to the ground from which you were made. For you were made from dust, and to dust you will return. And with that recognition that death is inevitable, death is part of living, yet death has always had a darker meaning. The grave was always ominous. But then came Jesus. We Christians now have a chance to look at life through the lens of the crucifixion and the resurrection. We no longer have to fear death because of the life and death and resurrection of our Savior. However, we must have humility in our lives and repentance in our spirit because we don't deserve what Jesus has done for us. Because of Calvary, Jesus took the sting out of death. Because of Calvary, he took the sting out of the grave. And as the Apostle Paul says, and thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus. So we exist today because of God's grace and God's mercy. We have achieved nothing on our own. And so we're here this evening to acknowledge our mortality and to seek forgiveness for our arrogance and our sinfulness. The cross that will be imposed upon our foreheads for those who choose to do so is an outward sign of our sorrow and repentance for our sins. And thus, as we enter the season of Lent, we enter with prayer, with contrition, and finding means of expression of gratitude so that we don't forget what Jesus has done for us. Over the next few weeks, we as a caravan will travel to parts of Oxnard, Corpadini, and the city of Ventura to celebrate this Lenten season with 8 participating congregations. We will highlight the victory from the cross by preaching from the 7 last sayings on the cross. And tonight, we look at the first saying coming from the 24th chapter of Luke, in the 33rd verse, where Jesus says, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. The Gospel of Luke uses few words to capture one of the most enduring scenes of the New Testament. Luke writes, they came to a place, they nailed him to the cross, and there were 3 of them, Jesus and 2 criminals, filing the soldier's gavel for his clothes by throwing dice. But if we were looking through a movie camera and began to pan from the cross to the crowds that had gathered, we'd see 4 different groups of people around the cross. There were the women who cried, and the crowd that jeered, the soldiers that mocked him, and the religious rulers who sneered at him, and then there was a criminal who hurled insults at him. While this was going on, other Roman soldiers were gambling for his clothes. The very last moments of Jesus were chaotic, and in the midst of this crying and jeering and sneering and insulting noise, the the voice of Jesus shouts, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." His voice had to start with them. Those were the first words they heard from him while he hung on the cross, and they weren't prepared for the magnitude of what he said. In my imagination, I believe there was a hush that came over the crowd because they were trying to digest what they thought they heard him say. And so perhaps maybe he said it again with more force. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." Some had to look around and say, "Who's he talking to?" Somebody said, "He's praying. Father, who's this Father?" The women knew, because they had learned the prayer he had taught his disciples. But the women couldn't speak up, so they began to weep again. It was a reminder to them of who Jesus is and the Son of God. But the religious people, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the experts of the law didn't know what he meant. They had no idea what Jesus had, that Jesus had that kind of relationship with God. Nobody prays to God, "The great I am, the able human him, the one who some would say Yahweh." No one calls God Father. So the religious people did not understand what he was saying. And the criminals that were hanging on the cross, they couldn't understand either that he was praying, "Father, forgive them." Forgive them? That's kind of strange language coming from the killing grounds at Calvary. Right. Forgiveness not for himself, but for others. I'm certain the soldiers had heard persons confessing their last dying breaths before, but they never said, "Father, forgive them." Who is them? You can see this picture that Luke had painted. Who could them be? Could it be the religious leaders who were so bigoted and narrow in their view of the Holy Book, so self-righteous to the point that they could not see Jesus as who he really is? They were so self-righteous, clearly they knew they did not need forgiving. They couldn't see how they had misused religion to oppress the poor and trap people into religious bondage, and they could not see the Messiah. They should have known better, but they didn't. "Father, forgive them." Are there any other persons of interest? How about the crowd? Didn't they know Jesus after all? Or were they the ones that were just swayed by the religious leaders of their day? And it didn't matter, it just didn't make sense to them. Giving a choice between a convicted criminal and Jesus, they chose the free Barabbas. And although some in the crowd may have been healed by Jesus, some in the crowd may have been fed by Jesus, but now they were all part of the mob. And the mob has the mentality of the lowest common denominator. And the mob was saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." For many in the crowd that afternoon had been led to go for the entertainment of crucifixion. So, "Father, forgive them." Is that who Jesus is talking about? Are there any other persons of interest? What about the disciples? Where were his disciples? The ones that had been tutored by Jesus for more than 3 years. The ones that saw him heal the sick and feed the hungry and bring sight to the blind and restore hearing. They saw Jesus calm the angry sea and restore broken people and broken bodies. Where were his disciples? They had abandoned him. They had seen demons flee and crazy people get being restored to their right mind. They were with Jesus when they heard Peter's confession that "You are the Christ, Son of the living God." They even sat with Jesus on that last supper. But now, where are the disciples? "Father, forgive them." Was Jesus talking about his disciples? Or are there other persons of interest? Oh, There, then is, might not be good English, but it's good theology. No, there we are. Father, forgive us, for we know not what we do. When we do need forgiveness, don't you know? When we have fallen, we have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We need forgiveness because we need God's grace and mercy. We need forgiveness because we are the ones that have been polluting the streams and the oceans and the air and killing off the animals and driving them to extinction. We are the ones who have failed to do what Jesus asked his disciples to do. Make more disciples. Aren't we the ones that have let him down? Didn't he ask for those who followed him to be his witnesses and to make disciples of all nations? Yet as we look at the churches in Ventura County or in California or in the United States, the numbers that are filling those churches are getting fewer and fewer. Could Jesus be looking from the cross and looking over the generations yet to come and say, Father, forgive them because they are not doing their job? Yes, as he hung from the cross, he could see that some of the people that he had blessed, who woke up this morning with activities of their limbs, have not done what Jesus has asked them to do, like feed the sick, or feed the hungry, and take care of the sick, and visit those in prison. Instead, we applaud the prison industrial complex. We are them who allow our political leaders to mistreat foreigners in our land, and allow our sisters and brothers to be called illegal and be deported because all they want is decent living. We are them who permit the objectification of women, the hatred of same-sex gender-loving people, the victimization of the weak, the victimization of the people of color, and the elderly and the poor. We are them who have not spoken truth to power. We are them who, although we have the power that God has given us, are not using our power for the glory of God. So when Jesus was praying, looking out over centuries and saying to us, Father, forgive them, forgive us for the sins that we have committed. Forgiveness is very much part of what it is to be a Christian. Jesus taught it over and over again. Peter was a slow learner. He said, Jesus, wait a minute, I understand forgiveness, but isn't that it? Finite number? Seven times? Eight times? Nine times? No, Jesus says 70 times seven. Peter, you're not supposed to count. You're just supposed to forgive. And as Jesus was from the cross, he was saying, Father, forgive them, because he was demonstrating what was so important to his ministry. In the Sermon from the Mount, he said, that I say to you, love your neighbor, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you, children. Father, forgive them as he taught from the plains. But to you who are willing to listen, he said, love your enemies. Do to those who hate you. Do good to those who hate you. Do to others as you would want them to do unto you. Jesus was showing them the way and showing us the way. Yes, it is hard, but we ought to hear the message from the cross one more time. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Today, in Portland, Florida, a confused young man of 19 years of age took an AK rifle and killed at least 17 people. Yes, God, pray for the victims and pray for their families. But if that had happened at Oxnard High School, And this was our gathering tonight. One of the messages that we would still have to say is that, Father, forgive him, for he know not what he does. We can't get angry and mad and talk about vengeance and violence when people hurt one another. We need to hear what our Savior has told us. And so we come this evening with the reminder that in our spirits, as we get up each day, in our spirits, as we walk down the road, in our experience, as we walk with the mark of ashes on our forehead, that our message must be, as we hear it from Jesus, Father, forgive them.
Yes, Lord.
For they know not what they do.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
pray. Holy One, wash away our guilt and cleanse us from our shortcomings. For we have transgressed against you and turned away from your paths. You desire truth and not iniquity, yet we reject the wisdom you place in our hearts. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within us. Do not cast us away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from us. Lead us unto you in the paths of life, that we might return to you with all our hearts. In the name of the Messiah, we pray. Amen. And hear these wonderful words of assurance. Hear the words of the prophet Joel. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your hearts, with fasting, with weeping, and with sorrow. Tear your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for God is merciful and compassionate, very patient, full of faithful love, and always ready to forgive. Amen. Even now, it is not too late to return to the Lord. When we come before God with a contrite heart, mercy and love awaits us. Now is the acceptable time to offer our hearts to God. Now is the day of salvation. We can't wait until we're worthy to approach the throne. The ashes that will be given to you are reminders that we would never be worthy on our own, but the cross that awaits at the end of this journey proclaims that even imperfect mortals like us are worthy of God's love and salvation. Here is the amazing irony. As we wear the ashes of mortality and sin on our foreheads, we are proclaiming God's victory over these very elements, death and sin. Truly now is the acceptable time to offer our hearts to God. And we will be praying over the pastor, marking on your foreheads as the way that God is in control, that God is love, God will give, and God cares. Let us pray. Merciful God, you ask us to rend our hearts and not our clothing. In the dust of these ashes, we come face to face with the shortcomings of our own humanity. Help us resist the temptation to wash away the dust, for we know that it was from the dust itself that you created us. Wash us. Wash our hearts and mark us with ashes on the outside, that we might be made clean on the inside. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And I'll ask the Caravan pastors to come forward to receive the ashes. And the ushers will be ushering you where you should be going to get the imposition of the ashes. Thank you.
he's at Lenten. Okay, so under the two, thank you. Okay, no, okay.
Thank you.
churches where the subsequent services will be taking place every Thursday from now on, starting that next week on Thursdays. And if you would please take this home with you and put it somewhere where you will remember to take a look at every week. And remember that this Lenten season continues as we worship together every Thursday. Thank you.
Shall we stand for the benediction? And he cried from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." His prayer was not just for those gathered at the cross, but the prayer was also for us. Heaven is full of forgiven people. We need to be forgiven. So now by the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, bless you, and bless you, and bless you, and bless us all, henceforth, now, and forever.